All right, so thanks for coming to our second Infectious Disease Genomic Epi workshop. As Anne mentioned, we started this last year sort of in response to demands from both public health and some academia interested in learning how to apply genomics in clinical and public health microbiology. Last year, we focused a lot on public health because most of us, as you heard, came from the public health side. But this year, we added some more applications that are applicable to clinical microbiology as well. And also, last year, we focused a lot on bacteria, but with the advance in technology and so on, this year, we actually added some viral components as well. I don't think we're covering parasite quite yet, but a lot of the analysis still do apply. And my job here for the first module is to give a general introduction of the course material and the content and also the background to help everyone sort of get on the same page. So feel free to stop me anytime if you have any questions. The lecture will probably take about 60, 70 minutes with some interruption is totally fine. And so for the, it's a packed workshop, as Anne mentioned, and we have divided the workshop into 7 different modules plus a keynote talk. And each of the module will be followed by a hands-on tutorial session except this first one and the keynote. So you'll actually get to practice while we discussed in the lecture material, I didn't list it here is we also will have a brief tutorial right after this about how to use the Amazon Web Services and how you can use that to analyze your data. So we set up Amazon Cloud Instance for every one of you. And tomorrow we will also show you how to access to another analysis platform that collectively the instructor created and worked on in the last few years. And it's a web-based platform that you can upload your data and do some analysis as well. In terms of the actual course content, for module 2, you'll hear from Gary about phylogenetic analysis and how to detect single nucleotide variants and how to use that for transmission studies and for other applications. Modules 3, you'll hear from Dylan about molecular subtyping, mainly focus on gene-based or allelic-based molecular typing method, such as MLST, using whole genome sequence data. And then this evening, Fiona, who just walked in, will give a broad picture keynote. And Fiona, do you want to quickly introduce yourself?
University, very interested in microbial bioinformatics, but also some lab training, and I'm very happy to be here.
Okay, and tomorrow, Brian Early, you'll hear from, what am I talking about? Andrew. Oops. I only got like 4 hours of sleep, and from Vancouver, this is like 5 in the morning for me. So, anyway, from Andrew about the, and a lot of you mentioned about antimicrobial resistance being your research interest. So Andrew will talk about the identification of AMR genes from whole genome data and some of the resources that will be available to you to do that. Module 5. On phylogenetic analysis. This lecture was typically developed by Rob Beacole, who developed Genghis, which is a tool that allows you to combine phylogenetic trees with geographic locations. He can't make it this year, so Anna will cover the lecture and will also talk a bit about the visualization aspect. And module 6, Gary will talk about emerging pathogen detection, and this is where the idea is you can search for potential pathogens in metagenomics data, and we'll introduce some
viral applications in this case as well. Module 7, and I will talk about data visualization, some of the principles behind it, some of the good practices behind data visualization, and you also have a hands-on tutorial on developing some of these visualizations yourself and look at the data in different from different angles and different lights. So the general learning objective for this workshop is to understand how genomic epidemiology can improve clinical and public health microbiology. You'll learn to process genomic sequence data using a variety of bioinformatics tools. The focus of the workshop is not so much on how you process the sequence data, because a lot of the tools are readily available, so we won't necessarily go into the details on how you will assemble and annotate your genomes, but rather focus more on the downstream once you have those, once you have a sequence process, how you can use for genomic epi investigation and other applications. And we also will talk about how you can interpret your genomic data in epidemiological context and perform several types of gen epi analysis, and that's sort of the meat of the workshop. And understand the fundamental data visualization. And as you can imagine, we're dealing with heterogeneous data sets are highly complex, so some of these visualization techniques can really improve your ability to interpret the data. And last but not least is this is a rapidly evolving field, so we also want you to go home with a sense that there are limitations and challenges still associated with genomic epidemiology analysis. And this is an active research area that people are working on, even though a lot of the work can now be operationalized, as I'll show in a bit. So for this particular module, the learning objectives are become familiar with high-throughput sequencing and its application in clinical and public health microbiology. Be familiar with the sequence data processing, so I'll go over the process briefly in this introduction. Be able to recognize the importance of metadata and sequence analysis and data integration. And lastly, I'll give a brief overview of the other modules. And as I was doing the introduction, I was saying that I'll talk a bit about my research. The one of the important message for the workshop is that sequence data cannot stand on its own. You need the metadata to facilitate the analysis, but metadata cannot stand on its own either, as you sometimes don't get the resolution that you need to make interpretation. So the importance of being able to bring the two together is actually what my lab is interested in. So half of my group worked on the sequence analysis aspect, and I'll mention about that in a bit. And the other half of my group actually works on data harmonization and data standardization approaches to improve the quality of metadata. Okay, so we live in an increasingly interconnected world. This is the commercial flight path. As of 2014 was so, and just like, you know, people and goods can travel around the globe rapidly, pathogens can be carried with these travelers, animals and goods quite rapidly and spread around the globe through international travels. And a case to point is this study done in a few years ago, looking at the actual human waste from long-haul flights. So a Danish group collected samples from 18 different flights from three different continents and filtered through 400 liters of human waste and extracted the DNAs and sequenced the DNA using metagenomics approaches. And they then clustered the sample based on the microbiome profiles that they observed, and also searched for antimicrobial resistant genes in the data set. So what they found is actually that the samples do cluster with geographic locations. And as you can see here, the North American clusters forms its own distinct cluster, or two clusters actually, whereas the northern is split into Northern Asia and Southern Asia form their distinct clusters as well, based on the microbes found in these samples. And also by looking at the antimicrobial resistant genes, they found that certain samples, namely the ones from South Asia, actually have higher proportions of antimicrobial resistant genes in the human waste or human excrete. So it's a nice study just to show how you can do global surveillance by monitoring flights. And as you can imagine, if the pathogens are secreted in human waste, they're carried into the destination that these travelers go to as well. And another study looked at the emergence of infectious disease events, and EID events are defined as newly evolved strains of pathogens in human, excluding re-emerging pathogens. So they, for example, did not count the recent re-emergence of Ebola outbreaks or Zika outbreaks, but they count the first instance of a particular pathogen or a new variant of that pathogen getting into the human population. So this is done over the last, this survey was done over the past six decades or so, since the 1940s. And the pattern is clear that there's a steady increase of these emerging infectious disease events in the last few decades. And they attribute the increase in 1980s to HIV and related pandemics, but I don't know if they fully understood why there's a slight drop in 2000. But in any case, the increasing trend is quite consistent, and it's dominated by zoonotic pathogens that are hopping over from animal populations into the human population. And in the study, they were also able to then identify global hotspots where these EID events occur. And perhaps not too surprisingly, South Asia is also one of these hotspots. So you have a combination of high probability higher probability, I should say, of newly emerging infectious diseases, coupled with an increased antimicrobial resistant genes as well, creating kind of a perfect storm that might be of interest in. And that's with a lot of the public health agencies and groups do closely monitor the region. So in a subsequent paper that's just published last year, I think, 2017, they also identify some of the risk factors associated with these emerging infectious disease events, and namely being tropical forests where there's dense population, both human and animals, and rich species diversity and climate effects are all significant risk factors associated with emergence of new infectious diseases. Now, so all that is to really illustrate the importance of infectious disease in our modern society, and perhaps the outbreak a few years ago of Ebola in West Africa is still fresh in people's minds. Most deadly Ebola outbreak in the history, resulting in about 28,000 cases, reported cases, so the actual cases is likely to be higher, and also 11,000 or so death over the span of 3 years or so. It has significant impacted the global travel. I remember when at BCCDC, even though there's no case in Canada, we still have to go through, well, not me personally, because I'm a bioinformatician, we don't really go into the field, but the technicians and the biosafety officers have to go through rigorous trainings in handling in case the Ebola case were detected in Canada. So it's quite a resource intensive exercise to prepare for potential outbreaks. And it again highlights the global natures of infectious diseases, that infectious disease in one region, if it's significant enough, can actually have a global impact. So the Ebola genomes, what's different between this particular outbreak and the previous ones is that with the maturation of sequencing technologies, about 5% of the cases were sequenced, and the genomes of these Ebola viruses are available for analysis. And this is really the one of the best examples of how genomic epidemiology really facilitate the research and the health care interventions of an outbreak. So this study is one of the earlier studies that look at just the 99 early isolates, and using just sequence data alone, but then later corroborated with the epidemiological evidence, they were able to show that the human exposure to nature, to a natural reservoir, is likely to be a single one-time event, because there's only they were only detecting sort of one original case then spread human to human through human to human transmission. And this is likely due to the funeral practice and the lack of proper quarantine in these West African countries that have never seen Ebola viruses, Ebola outbreaks before. But they also, from the phylogenetic tree, they were able to show that the incursion of Ebola from Guinea into Sierra Leone might actually, even though the IP evidence suggests it's a single event, might actually have introduced two different strains of Ebola into the country. So as you can see, there's a split here of two distinct lineages, one here and one down here. And this type of detailed information really helped the care workers trace the transmission and understand how these viruses are transmitted. And the result was able to influence some of the policies and some of the interventions. However, as I mentioned, a lot of death occurred, and it still took quite a few years to finally have the outbreak under control. So fast forward to 2018, some of you might know that there's currently another Ebola outbreak in the Democratic Republic and the Republic of Congo. So what's different from of this outbreak from the previous one is that DRC has already experienced multiple Ebola outbreaks before, so they're more aware of the symptoms to look out for, and they're more aware of how to deal with the patients. And the death toll currently stands around 50 or so, so it's much more well-controlled outbreak. And other reasons for the outbreak being under control is that there's a faster mobilization of resources. So since the original Ebola outbreak, WHO and World Bank have set up some reserve funds to deal with public health emergencies, and their team put in place to be able to quickly mobilize to deal with these public health emergencies. They also have been able to use the previous outbreak as an opportunity to test out the Ebola vaccine that was actually developed at the National Microbiology Lab in Canada, and they were able to stockpile these vaccines for future outbreaks. In this case, they were able to treat the high risk patients and sorry, not patient, high risk individuals with these vaccines, and also experimental drugs and were developed, and outside health workers were, as mentioned, able to be in position faster for this outbreak. But we really need to be constantly in alert to be aware of these potential infectious disease outbreaks that can can be devastating if not not quickly managed, and hence the importance of a genomic epi-based surveillance to monitor pathogens is what the community as a whole is working toward. So unlike Ebola outbreaks, Zika virus cause much milder symptoms, and it's often self the disease is self eliminating, and most people who have been exposed to the disease developed immune response to it, and it has been an endemic in both Africa and Asia Africa for much longer, but Asia for at least the last half a century or so before causing an outbreak in between 2015 and 2016 in Americas. And the outbreak resulted in few thousand cases of microcephaly cases. And the likely reason is that the general population in Americas are naive to this virus. So when they are first exposed to the virus, there's more likely to have complications and to develop in the process of developing immune response might have caused issues such as microcephalies in fetus. And so it's still an open question why microcephaly wasn't observed in, you know, Asia and in Africa to the same extent. But it's also possible, some people are proposing, based on the genomics data that were generated, that maybe a recent mutation of the viruses has also increased its virulence and might be dealing with a more virulent strain of Zika. And also to highlight, because of the symptoms of Zika virus is similar to some other flaviviruses, such as dengue virus, the syndromic base or surveillance based on observing of symptoms can actually be unreliable, and you can miss cases. So serological or genomic or molecular testings are needed for confirmation. And again, through the genomic analysis, it was later on realized that the virus probably had been in circulation in Americas, specifically in Brazil, for at least a year or so before it was recognized as an outbreak. And such gap in surveillance is likely to increase the magnitude of the outbreak. So as I mentioned, genomic space surveillance moving forward can also can reduce such gap and can improve our ability to identify potential outbreaks. So another example, here's a flight path of a different kind. So these are the migratory bird flight path. And the reason I'm showing this is that these migratory birds are actually natural reservoirs for influenza viruses. And through these migratory pathways, the influenza virus, specifically avian influenza, can actually spread around the world. And also, you notice that some of these flyways actually overlap each other, so it gives opportunities for the virus genomes to reshuffle and create new variants of the virus. And influenza virus, many of you know, caused four large-scale human pandemics in the past 100 years, and 2018 is actually the centennial of the 2018 Spanish influenza pandemic. And the pandemic strains are typically hypervirulent and typically arise from the mixing of human and animal flu viruses. And these migratory birds such that do have in their sort of process of being the natural host of these influenza viruses have developed some resistance, so they don't typically get EO from the viruses. But then the viruses can be passed on to domestic poultry populations, which are highly susceptible to these viruses, at least to certain variants of these viruses. So also to related to human health, occasionally the virus can infect human, it can jump over to human. And typically when a country observed, or at least in North America, if we observed avian influenza culling of the birds, the domestic poultry's population is the only solution right now. So in 2014-2015, there was a medium scale outbreak of avian influenza in North America. It's believed that the Asian strain of H5NA and H5N1 mixed with the North American strain somewhere in Alaska, and in that process, the highly virulent version of the H5 virus get carried down through these wild bird migratory passes along the coast and into the U.S. And in BC, the Fraser Valley is where we raise all our poultry, where we have all our poultry operation. And as a result of the incursion of the H5 and H5 virus in the poultry population, essentially 13 farms were affected, and about a quarter million birds had to be destroyed, and cost the industry about $300 million. Once it got into the U.S., it scaled up, and the estimate was damage to the industry is about $3 billion, and directly translate to about 80% increase in egg prices in the States. So these diseases can have a wide impact, not just for human, but also for trade and for economy. And during that time, Genome BC got interested in how we can improve the surveillance of these influenza viruses. So we received some funding together with the Ministry of BCCC. I mean, see some funding with Ministry of, together with Ministry of Agriculture to come up with a better ways of doing influenza surveillance. So before I jump into that, the current approach to doing influenza surveillance for birds is through bird-based testing. So both passive, in other words, testing dead birds, and active capturing and testing of live birds or hunter kill birds for influenza viruses. As I mentioned, because most of the wild waterfowls are not killed by influenza viruses, so looking for dead waterfowls does not really improve your chance of detecting these viruses. As a result, the overall positivity rate for detecting viruses in the bird is quite minimum. It's approximately 1% or so. And for that particular 2015 outbreaks, we failed to detect these high pathogenic strains of influenza virus in the waterfowl before it got into the poultry population. So we developed an environmental genomic-based surveillance approach, and this is still ongoing work in my group. And the process involved isolating and enriching for influenza genomic RNAs from wetland sediment samples. And we go to wetlands where these wild waterfowls congregate, and the viruses are excreted through their fecal material. So the wetlands act as their outdoor toilet, essentially, and this type of approach does not then depend on the capture of birds. However, because the environment does dilute out the virus, it is like finding a needle in a haystack, so we have to develop both enrichment method and also improved bioinformatic method to detect these viruses in the environment. But as you can see here, the punchline is the overall positivity rate is much higher. And in the wetland samples, it's about 25% positive. And the farm samples, of course, where the it was known to have the viruses, the positivity rate is much higher. And this is just from the environment around the farm, not necessarily not direct sampling of the birds. And we are also able to detect the specific outbreak strains in our samples rather than just a different strain. So it's a proof of concept that show that genomic-based approach can actually be used for environmental surveillance. So Andrew will talk a lot more about AMR. So I'm just giving a quick example here where many of the AMR genes encoded in mobile elements can move around from host to host. So detecting of genes based on PCR without sort of the genomic background or the detection of or the identification of the specific bacteria without knowing whether the AMR genes there or not. So if you just identify based on culture or based on other method without knowing the AMR gene is there or not, are both insufficient to establish the transmission route for the or the patterns for these AMR genes. So this study, for example, showed that these columns here show the AMR patterns, and you can see the AMR patterns do not really correlate to the phylogenetic tree based on, I think in this case, MLST analysis, really highlighting the importance of being able to identify both the genes and the genomic background. And whole genome sequencing, of course, is an approach to give you that information. The caveat being the current sequencing methodology, it still requires some work to pull out both the plasmids and the genomic chromosomal background. So it's still a work in progress for these type of application. So this is an interesting study highlighting how they did that. Now, I mentioned quite a few studies, so you might think that we're still not prime time yet. We're still not operationalizing genomic epidemiology, but in fact, the Public Health England lab have been sequencing all their Salmonella isolates since 2014 and have been using that to establish genomic-based clustering and use that to detect outbreaks. So I gave some references down here, but there's actually a paper that summarized their experience. I'll make that available through through our course website. US FDA also have established a centralized data repository and analytical platform called Genome Tracker for both US and global partners. And I think Fiona will mention a bit more about that in her talk, and really highlighting that you can do genomic-based surveillance in real time or semi-real time to help address outbreak, in this case, foodborne diseases. Okay. So just before we get into the some of the technologies, I'll first define that what I meant by genomic epidemiology. I sort of keep it quite simple as just to say that it's the combination of whole genome sequence data from pathogens. Just to separate out from the idea of whole genome sequencing of the host or the human. And combining the sequence data with the epidemiological investigation to track the spread of infectious diseases. And the epidemiological data provide the contextual information for interpretation of genomic sequence data. And the genomic sequence data provide high-resolution diagnostic information helping to shape the direction of the epidemiological analysis investigation. So this is an improvement over the current clinical microbiology laboratory practice, which required the lab to maintain a large number of different tests and different media to support the identification of different pathogens. And also, of course, comes with its different diagnostic platforms, machines you have to maintain, so on and so forth. This sort of showing you some of the tests that are regularly performed in a public health or diagnostic health microbiology lab. And due to the regulatory and validation requirements, sometimes developing a new assay or new test, it's a slow process. And moreover, some of these methods can take weeks or months. Sometimes you have to send the samples away, actually. So we regularly send samples to the National Microbiology Lab if it's for a specialized test. And that just the transportation process alone and getting on a queue could sometimes take weeks, if not months, depending on the test. So genomic sequencing of pathogens promised to simplify that workflow. So instead of maintaining an array of different platforms, you essentially have to maintain a sequencing platform and use, and also you have to maintaining or at least be able to carry out the bioinformatic analysis downstream of your sequence generation. But many of the pathogens then can be sequenced and analyzed without having to maintain a large array of other tests. So the benefit includes simplified workflow, as I mentioned, and also in most cases, you can guarantee a turnaround time if you're doing the sequencing and analysis in-house, because you know how long the sequencing will take, how long the analysis will take. So it then depends on how quickly can you get the samples processed for sequencing. It's a over time, it should achieve cost saving by reducing the number of platforms and instruments that you need to maintain. And also, sequencing itself is becoming cheaper and cheaper by the day. The one of the really value-added bonus for sequencing is that the result of your sequences is actually comparable. So it really doesn't matter where you generate a sequence. By and large, the sequence data are comparable. And moreover, it's digitized format, right? So it's making sharing of the data easier as well. And you can perform value-added analysis, value-added research on the sequence data, as I've shown in some of in the Ebola and the Zika examples. So some of the challenges include that the results are harder to process, interpret. Whole genome sequencing, for example, give you a large amount of data, so you do need specialized computer resources, bioinformatic resources, to process that information. There's also a rapid change in technology. As I mentioned, sometimes validating a test can take a long time. So when you have a technology that's fast evolving, how do you deal with the accreditation or the validation of the platform? So a few months ago, I was at a conference. So US CDC is just sort of talking about how they are going through this accreditation process for CLIA, which is the clinical the body that maintains clinical lab accreditation in the U.S., and detailing how labor intensive and time intensive it's to validate a genomic test for their foodborne disease program. And the other issue is that if you have low throughput, then the per sample cost can be very high, and often you need to accumulate enough samples and do batch processing to reduce the cost. But many of the labs don't necessarily have the volume to sustain this high level activity. So it becomes, again, whether you centralize the sequencing service where you can, or you do it distributedly, but then have to absorb the cost for the lower volume, the cost due to lower volume. So I talked for, I guess, 30 minutes or so, and I'll pause for a bit and just want to open up the discussion. Do other people, do you have any experience with applying whole genome sequencing, and are there any benefits and challenges that you have observed in your own work? Anyone?
I'm running into that challenge of batching some kind of sending samples out for NGS, but nobody will run into that.
Enough samples, yeah. Yeah, so that's a common problem, and often sequencing can be done in a few days, but you might be in the queue for a few weeks or a few months. So one of the reasons why we're not, a lot of the time we're still not doing this in real time. Yeah.
So the problem to that, so I've heard of you doing the ICs
Does anyone
have any experience of the IC?
Like small volumes? Anyone? Any other thoughts on what are some of the potential challenges or benefits? So how many people are actually doing genomic sequencing of their samples and are doing analysis at the moment? Okay, so about half of you. And what about the other half? Are you just receiving data and then want to do analysis? Yeah, okay. Yeah, so we'll go into now the bioinformatics aspect a bit more. Oh, actually, before I do that, so I just wanted to, introduce a bit of doubt about high-throughput sequencing. So the term high-throughput sequencing had gradually sort of been becoming more popular to the next-gen sequencing, although you still see that a lot. And part of the reason is, it's a clarification between what's next-gen sequencing versus what's so-called third-gen sequencing. That's based on single molecular sequencing. So the sort of by using high throughput sequencing, it sort of creates a collective term that you don't have to worry about whether you're talking about Illumina sequencing or you're talking about MinION sequencing or PacBio sequencing, which are some of the third generation sequencers. And sequencing data have many laboratory utilities. It can be used for diagnostics, so you can do actually detailed strain level identification, can identify virulence genes, AMR genes from the sequence data alone. You can carry out surveillance, be it gene by gene type of surveillance or single nucleotide variant SNP type of surveillance. You can even do in silico serotyping, so based on the genomics data, predict the serotype. And you can also use the sequence data to identify copy number variants. So, and the information can then be used for outbreak detection and investigation. So you can carry out trace back and you can carry out transmission route analysis and so on, use the sequence data in combination with the epi investigation. So, So I think most people probably are familiar with Illumina-based sequencing. That's sort of the current workhorse for generating a large amount of short reads from your samples. How many of you have heard of MinION? All of you? Great. So I don't have to talk. I don't have to introduce it. But this is a sort of a small form factor sequencer that give you a longer read, but at a much lower fidelity. But it does promise to be portable and highly versatile So this graph shows the cost decrease in sequencing DNA. And you can see an inflection point here that shows when next generation sequencers were introduced, there's a rapid decrease in cost. And also notice this is in log scale, so the drop is I think it's about 10 to the 14th fold drop since 2001 in terms of pricing. So right now it costs about that's 1 cent per megabase. And of course, show of hand, how many people are sequencing their genomes at 1 cent per megabase? Anyone? No? So the caveat here is that this is a highly optimized, highly batched solution. So this data comes from the National Human Genomic Research Institute. They sponsor some large-scale sequencing centers, and this is the cost of these large-scale sequencing centers, their per megabase cost. So what's important to take from this is really there's a significant drop in price, but if you translate to a medium or small-sized lab, you're still looking at somewhere between $15 to $200 per sample and roughly per genome. And if you're dealing with metagenomic samples, the cost could be higher because you may need much higher coverage for the samples depending on your application. So a quick summary, a reminder of what pathogen genomes look like. So for bacteria, it's typically a single circular chromosome with some exceptions. It's a haploid genome, meaning there's only one copy of a given gene, or one allele, I should say, of a given gene in the genome, and may have extra chromosomal elements or plasmids that are carried around with the chromosome. The genome sizes range from about 0.5 megabase to about 10 megabase. Average, especially for pathogens, typically is about in the middle, 3 to 5 megabase, correspond to about 3,000 to 5,000 genes. The viral genomes, of course, are typically smaller. They can be both DNA and RNA, and the next-gen sequencing platform typically only dealing with DNA sequencing, even though now you can do RNA direct sequencing on the MinION, but the efficiency is still much lower than DNA-based sequencing. So often you're dealing with cDNAs or reverse transcription of the RNA viruses before you can carry it out sequencing. And the range is somewhere from 1 to 2 KB to 1 to 2 megabase, which is it's quite unusual to see such large genomes for viruses because they're usually quite compact and depend on the host cellular mechanisms to replicate. I heard some of you are working with eukaryotic parasites, which include fungi, protists, and worms. And they're usually few megabases to few hundred megabases. And usually have multiple chromosomes, so there are some exceptions, such as Giardia, where some of the yeast are only about 12 megabases, so they're about the size of a large bacterial genome with no introns. But typically, when you're dealing with eukaryotic parasites, because of the more complex gene structures, the downstream processing is more complex as well, whereas bacteria and viruses were getting quite good at doing the gene annotations with these pathogens. And there are several dominant evolution-driving forces that are changing the genomes. I'm just listing some of them here, such as the genome can be reduced over time, so-called sort of specialized specialization, where the organisms become specialized to a specific niche, and as a result, they come sort of lean and mean and reduce the excess requirement for maintaining a larger genome. There's constant rearrangements in most of the microbial bacterial genomes, and the gene duplication followed by diversification of gene functions is another force of change in the genomes. And of course, in many microbes, the lateral gene transfer is a big driving force as well. The acquisition of non-parental or DNA material or RNA material from non-parental strains and recombination can quickly change the bacterial genomes. And because of all these driving forces, we actually, instead of sequencing a handful of genomes, typically have to sequence hundreds, if not thousands, of genomes to really characterize a single pathogen species well. Okay, so this is sort of outlining the whole genome shotgun sequencing approach. And what I want to just highlight is that because there's no cloning stage and the DNA fragments are typically just quickly PCR amplified, and sometimes this step is even skipped before sequencing. So you can streamline the process compared to the previous Sanger-based approach. And it's also highly parallelized, so you generate a lot of data in a short period of time. Now, moving into sequence data analysis. So in the sequencing step, especially on the next-gen platform such as Illumina, the DNA is broken down into smaller fragments that are sequenceable in size. They're typically a few hundred base pairs long. So you generate millions to billions of such short sequences, fragments, and you sequence them. And so typically the downstream process to before you can analyze the data is you have to put the fragments back together through a process called assembly. And then you have to annotate the sequences to provide functional information about the genes or about the non-coding regions. And then you can do compare the genomics to identify variants that are found in each of your genomes. So the genome assembly task is to reconstitute the whole genome if possible from fragments of DNA sequence. And there are two basic approaches. One is called de novo assembly. Essentially, you're just finding overlaps in your fragments and stitch them together based on the overlap. Kind of like putting back a jigsaw puzzle, finding the overlapping edges. The other is called mapping, or some people call it reference assist assembly, although mapping is probably a better term for it. So what you're doing essentially is you're mapping your sequences to an existing related reference genome. So keen to trying to essentially place each of these pieces back to using this reference picture, place back to where they belong. So of course, an easier process, but the challenge is that if your reference genome is diverged from your query genome or the genome that you're interested in, then your mapping-based approach is not going to give you a very accurate representation of your query genome. In addition to those challenges, there are sequencing errors of on all platforms that you have to deal with. So the assemblers have to be able to tolerate the sequencing errors. And also, one of the major challenges for short read-based assembly is that repetitive regions sometimes span or are bigger than each read. So when you're trying to piece them back together, two distinct repetitive regions could be collapsed into a single region because there's not enough information in your sequences to span the entire repetitive region. This is by and large addressable by using, say, MinION or Oxford Nanopore, or PacBio, that will allow you to generate longer sequences, hopefully span beyond the repetitive region. So this is quickly summarizing some of the common platforms that are still in use today for sequencing and the type of error and error rate. And I just want to highlight that Illumina has comparatively very low error rate, and it's typically a random error, so it's substitution error, so that happens randomly. Much easier to correct if you generate enough depth coverage. So by taking the consensus, then on average you'll get the right base rather than the wrong base. So the consensus approach can easily correct for substitution errors. The third generation sequencers still have greater than 10% error rate, so 1 in 10 base that you get from the sequencer will be incorrect. And on top of that, the third generation sequencers have, at least MinION, I should say, have errors that are more that are harder to correct. They're based on complications due to the signal processing process. So because of that, there are systematic errors that are sometimes harder to fix. And again, by sequencing to high depth coverage, you can fix some of the problem. But often a good practice is actually you will combine the MinION data with the Illumina data and use the high quality Illumina data to correct the sequencing errors in the MinION data. But effectively, that doubles or triples your cost per genome if you do it that way. Okay, so after assembly, there are often still gaps in the genome, so you are not getting the one-piece genome back. So we call that each of these fragments, these contiguous sequences, a contig. So I just wanted to introduce the term there so we're all on the same page. And the contigs likely to represent, in most of the cases, 97% plus of the genome, but you're still likely to miss some of the repetitive regions. And the process to close the gaps, or what's called a finishing approach, is often time-consuming and labor-intensive, because the old way of doing it is actually design PCR primers and walk the gap to try to close it. The new way of, as I mentioned, is that you use longer reads to try to span these repetitive regions. And some of the well-studied pathogens is now quite easy to get the full genome if you combine both sequencing technologies. All right, so the next topic is on genome annotation. So you get a string of ATC and Gs back from your sequencing providers, and there's really not much information attached to, or there's no, without the annotation process, there's not much information attached to the sequence. So the goal of annotation is to identify features such as genes or non-coding regions such as different RNA molecules or RNA genes in the genome. So typically want to find out the functions of the features and also the location where these features are in your chromosomal, or sorry, in your genomic sequence. Okay, so the location of coding genes, at least for bacteria and viruses, are easier to detect and to figure out than eukaryotes. And the sequences can often be identified through this ab initio gene prediction approach. And this algorithm essentially works on the fact that the coding regions have different base frequencies compared to non-coding regions. And if you train the software to recognize these words or these different coding frequencies, it can actually pretty reliably predict these regions for you in a context. So this is a fairly well resolved problem, and the sensitivity, at least for bacterial genomes, is somewhere in the 97-98% of the genes can be detected this way. So this sort of quickly summarizes the annotation process. You have a contact that you carry out some regional annotation and detect both the protein coding genes and the non-coding genes, such as RNA, tRNA, and other potentially small RNAs in promotion, sort of promoter regions, so on and so forth. And the protein coding genes can be detected through that initial gene prediction method, as I mentioned. And you then can annotate the functions of these genes by comparing to a reference database of known genes of known functions. And this can be done automatically, as you'll see in the workshop. And the manual annotation can be done as an option to improve the quality of your annotation. So the most common way to do functional prediction is through sequence similarity search. So I mentioned this is assuming that the genes that have sequence similarity are derived from the same ancestral gene, and therefore they have similar functions. So the most well-known similarity search tool is called BLAST. So how many people have used BLAST before? Just wanted to make sure. So everyone, okay. So so you know how it works. Basically, you're taking your sequence, search against a database of sequences that have already annotation assigned to it. So what you have to keep in mind is that that process creates what's called transitive annotation. In other words, you are you haven't done any sort of biochemical or functional characterization of your gene. You're simply determining the function of that gene or protein based on the similarity of that gene or protein to a known protein or gene. So that process can often create issues such as that your gene may be may have a different function than what's in the database due to a small mutation, but it's still BLAST to 99% identity. But and this is quite common in some of the AMR determinants, that small mutations can have a huge effect on the function of the gene. So you have to be careful when you're carrying out transitive annotations. Okay, so I think I can skip this slide, but maybe just to say that it is one of the most cited bioinformatic tools, and the reason it's so popular is that there's actually a statistical framework that was described around the BLAST search. So it's easier to predict the behavior of BLAST search results and to interpret the BLAST search result compared to some of the more heuristic approaches that are that does not have a statistical framework around it, and it then becomes harder to interpret some of the results from some of the other tools. So the different versions of BLAST searches, different combination of nucleotide and protein searches. I'm sure people are familiar with that. Now, so in terms of interpreting the BLAST search results, as I mentioned, it's based on a statistical framework, so there's the concept of expected value. And the expected value essentially is the number that the number of BLAST alignments with given scores that I expected to be seen simply due to chance. So does everyone know whether can anyone put that in a different word? Or does that sentence make sense to everyone? Yeah, show of hand, how many people can understand what that sentence
equipment? Most half of you, okay. So I just, I like, so the analogy that I typically give is it's just, if you walk on the street and see someone that look like you, what's the probability like that someone that look like you is actually related to you, right? So if you have a, like, maybe some of you have a face that's much more common. And aside from the fact that all humans are related to a certain degree, and certainly all proteins are related to a certain degree, we do want to figure out which ones are more closely related and which ones are which one looks similar just by chance. So the E-value given a statistical-based interpretation of the likelihood of finding a match purely due to chance. In other words, two unrelated sequences have similarities purely by chance. So the rule of thumb is that the blast alignment with expectation expected score greater than 0.1%, greater than 0.01, as I say, it's a number, not a percent, should typically not be trusted unless your sequences is really short and you have high identity to the BLAST database that you're using. So the gray zone is 0.01 to about 1. This you have to interpret accordingly. As I mentioned, if your sequences is very short, and because the expected value and scores are related, but the scores are based on factors such as the alignment length, and whereas expected value is adjusted based on the complexity of the sequences and the probability of finding a match in the database. So a combination of percent identity, which would be reflected in the score, and expected value can both be taken into consideration when you interpret the results. So there are quite a few automated annotation systems that use BLAST and other type of similarity search tools that potentially a lot faster. But BLAST is still considered the gold standard in terms of sensitivity. But if you have to search thousands, sometimes a metagenomic data set with hundreds of thousands of genes, then you potentially need a faster method than BLAST to search. And I think Fiona will mention some of that in her talk. But the idea of finding similarities of your query sequence in the data in the database record is the same. And in this workshop, we will actually use this PROCA, which is built into an analysis platform that I'll talk a bit to do automated annotation of your genome. But others are available as well that you can look into. So once you have the genomes, you can do comparative genomic analysis. And the goal of such analysis is to identify genomic variants that can be correlated to phenotypic or characteristic features of an organism. So, for example, might be interested in identifying a more virulent strain of a pathogen. So by looking for certain toxins, or by looking for non-virulence factors, or looking for antibiotic resistant genes. And we can also use the variants to track transmissions of the pathogens I mentioned already. At high level, the variants can occur at three different levels. One is regional. This is due to, for example, horizontal gene transfer acquiring a genomic island, or recombination events, or reshuffling of viral genomes and so on. So this can result in strain-specific regions or segments of genome that are different from strain to strain. And gene-based
analysis typically focus on strain-specific genes. So by doing gene-by-gene comparison, looking at the allelic differences, and this is the topic of Module 3 this afternoon. And nucleic acid, single nucleotide-based analysis, looking for variations at the base level, and this will be covered in the next session. So comparative genomics is not a new concept. Ever since the first genome was published in 95, soon after that, comparative analysis was already carried out, and this actually highlights some of the consistent observations of microbial genomes that really improved our understanding of bacterial evolution. And as you can see in this comparison, just two strains of H. pylori, that strain-specific genes typically cluster in so-called hypervariable regions and sometimes go genomic islands. As you can see, there's denoted by these blue regions. And this observation, as I mentioned, occurred over and over in other genomes as well, and leading to a lot of studies about genomic evolutions by horizontal gene transfer and so on. And I think Fiona would also talk more about that in her lecture. And extending comparative genomics to the concept of pangenome. So the large number of genomic variations means that you typically have to sequence a large number of genomes to really understand the bacterial species. And some species you might never have enough genomes that can allow you to thoroughly characterize a species. So the term was first coined in 2005 based on the study of six group B strep genomes. And what they define pangenome is the theoretical entire gene set of a species. And they break down into two broad categories, the core genome, which are consistently found in members of that species, and the strain-specific or accessory genes that are found sporadically in the different strains of that species. So the idea is that the core would be more stable and the strain-specific or the lifestyle genes would be more fluid and over time. So the pangenome calculation then is the extrapolation of the observed number of genes based on your limited number of genomes to the theoretical number of genes that are required to fully capture the pangenome of the species. And as I mentioned, some organisms, you'll not saturate its gene content. So that's called an open pangenome. So you can see some of these, that would these lines will never reach, at least not in a reasonable time, reaching zero, meaning that you'll continue to discover new genes as you sequence more genomes of that given species. So this is sort of, as you add one additional genomes, how many new genes are you discovering? So the number goes down. And for close pangenomes, the number can go down very quickly. So in the case of anthrax, the number of genomes need to sequence to characterize that organism is quite low, and partly it's a big because it's a newly emerged pathogen, relatively speaking, still like a few millennium years old, but the number of genomes required to describe it is trackable. And this, as you mentioned, that this concept helped the microbiologists to predict how species will evolve over time, whether it has an open pangenome and have a lot of horizontal gene transfer events and a lot of genomic changes, or it has a closed pangenome, meaning that it's a more stable genome. And this information is helpful in terms of interpreting your genomic epi results as well. So as I mentioned, pretty much everyone in the faculty is part of this IRIDA consortium. And a few years ago, Gary Fiona and I wrote a grant to Genome Canada to build an analysis platform for genomic epidemiology that's tailored to public health agencies and public health workers who lack the tools to process genomic data. And the idea is to have a free, open source, standard compliant, and high quality genomic epidemiology analysis platform to support real time disease outbreak investigations. And the core functions of the platform include managing of the users, managing of the projects and strains, but also built-in workflows that allow you to characterize these sequences. And there's also some visualization tools built in to allow you to visualize the trees and looking at the analytical results. Still an active project in development, and a lot of the core platform development happened at the NML in Gary's group, but Fiona's group also hosts a public instance at the Simon Fraser University that will create actually account for all of you, and you'll use some of that functionalities tomorrow in our integrated assignment. So I mentioned the goal is to build a platform that's easy enough to use for non-bioinformatics specialists. So mentioned it's a partnership of a lot of between both provincial and federal public health agencies, but also with a lot of academic partners. And the slide it's slightly out of date, but if you go to our website, there's a long list of partners involved. And the project teams, what's unique about the IRIDA partnership is that the project teams, such as Gary and I, are actually embedded in the together in the user organization. So we try to build tools that can tailor to the public health microbiology needs. And take feedback from the users to improve the process. But as I mentioned, we're opening up this platform. Actually, it has been open the whole time, but we're making it more readily available through this public instance. There's a few, so others can use it. But also, more importantly, if you're able to contribute to the development, we also happy to engage you for that as well. So the website, as I mentioned, is IRIDA.ca, where you can download, install your own copy, you can use a public instance, or you can read up on the documentation and so on. Okay, so it's designed to be user-friendly. You'll see this interface tomorrow. Basically, once you loaded your data, you just have to click this big red button to launch analysis. There's not much configuration needed to run fairly complex workflows, and you'll also be able to combine the metadata with the with your sequence analysis results. Okay, we're coming up to the hour, so I'll just go through this last bit fairly quickly. So switching gear into the metadata component. So there are many players involved in infectious disease surveillance and outbreak investigation. However, because of privacy and confidentiality concerns, the information tend to be aggregated the information collected at the frontline labs or the frontline agency investigation by the investigators typically are aggregated and lost as we move from the frontline labs to the more centralized centralized resource. But the bioinformatic expertise, on the other hand, typically start developed in a more resource-rich environment, such as a national lab, and is slow to propagate down to the frontline lab. And that's partly why the Eureta platform was developed, to try to equilibrate this process. But also it highlights the importance of how we can share the information across different players. So also to mention that different agencies have different analysis platforms, and this is like trying to fit a plug into the wall when you have different standards, right? So this should... Yeah, so there's a lot of retrofitting of data into the various standards in dealing with when we deal with data harmonization issues. And that's to say that the contextual information is often collected in institutional specific format. There's different codes or acronym used in different systems. There's our terminologies that describe the same concept but have different names, and there's different units of measurements, different, here's an example of different severity grade used by the American Hospital Association versus the UK, the NHS. And as you can see, the UK have much more finer gradients compared to the AHA standard. So how do you fit all these descriptors in a single gradient? It can be challenging and certainly difficult for software to understand such nuance. Another issue, of course, is metadata, often quite dirty. People are typing in the information. There's a lot of spelling errors. There's synonyms used. There's issues with the semantics used, such as grammatically incorrect terms and so on. So for example, here is the word cloud describing of different terms describing essentially feces. So the bigger, the more common terms are in larger fonts than the smaller ones. But you can see it's quite a mess. So ontology is the idea of ontology is that you can use it as a universal converter that allowed better interoperability and better harmonization of the data set through a mapping process. So ontology is a mechanism to study, to specify a body of knowledge, to specify an area of study, and essentially involves a standardized, well-defined hierarchy of terms that have a relationship describing their how these terms are related to each other. There's definitions for each term. And also each of the terms has a unique universal ID, so you're no longer bound by the actual words used to describe the concept. Rather, there's a universal ID assigned to each of the concept. So it allows you to use different synonyms for the same concept. And the terms are expressed in formats that are both human and computer readable. So, through this approach, you can improve the interoperability of data sets, and this is the area of research that are quite active in my group. So the idea is, for example, you can take these terms and then start mapping them to existing or to ontologies, and the different terms can be mapped to the same ID. Or even the same word, if they have two different usages, could be mapped to different IDs. But you're essentially expressing these terms in a more systematic way and more formalized way. So, and also, as I mentioned, each of the terms then have a clear definition. and the different ontologies are meant to be interoperable too. So you can reuse terms from one ontology to, in another ontology. So my group, with in collaboration with Fiona and Andrew, have in the last few years developed a application ontology that's specifically useful for genomic epidemiology investigations. And so we try to come through epi, lab, and genomic and clinical data types and data fields, and come up with consistent descriptors for these terms, and use these terms to describe, then use the terms to describe the activities. Because we're interested in foodborne infections, we also started a kind of interesting project that tried to come up with food descriptors from farm-to-fork activity. So for food products, for food processing steps, and for preservation method. And of course, this has applications beyond just infectious disease applications. So we have partners are interested in using this to describe their nutritional studies. We have partners interested in using this to describe the food web for environmental studies and so on. So again, the idea of being able to develop a knowledge framework that has wide applications and help to bring these different applications, the data from these different applications in a harmonized way. It's a interesting area for research. So this requires to develop an ecosystem, which I'll skip this slide. But the idea is that the ontology itself, if no one uses it, it's not useful. So we need to develop tools that would enable people to reuse the ontology. So one of the tools that we developed is called Genomic Epidemiology Entity MART. And this is trying to address the problem that people typically develop their data specifications in silos, resulting in slightly incompatible specifications, even though they're working in the same area. So the idea is to be able to come up with a platform that allow people to publish their data specification, but also to reuse ontology terms when they build their data specification, so that different data specification can be more interoperable to each other. But it also doesn't force people to adopt the same data specification. The other function built in is to improve the data consistencies by enforcing some data value constraints directly as part of your data specification, so you cannot type in random or erroneous text or information in a field, in a data field. And to make it user-friendly, we create a web interface that allow people to shop for terms and develop their data specification. So there's a link there. It's still a work in progress as well, but we're hoping to wrap this up later this year. The other issue that we try to deal with is that there are a lot of inconsistent terms in existing databases. So, but then to manually map them would be a labor-intensive process. So we try to developed an automated way method to map the database short phrases that you found in the databases, so the two different ontological terms. And in the process, it will clean up the inconsistencies in these terms and identify and map the corresponding the terms to the corresponding ontology. So this sort of outline all the steps that the system or the system that we call LexMapper go through to clean up the data. So just to summarize, the idea is to be able to draw your metadata descriptors from a body of ontologies that then can be published in genes and will cleaned up by LexMapper. That then, so you have a consistent descriptors for your metadata. And then you bring that together with standardized sequence analysis workflow, and both of that is critical for downstream genomic epidemiology analysis. here I put AeroDot, but it could be any of the of analysis platform that you use. The idea is still the same, that you want to have both clean or well processed sequence data and metadata for your analysis. I think I actually did cover most of the modules in my introduction, so I'll skip, given the time, I'll skip these. So this is just highlighting each of the modules. Sorry, it took longer than expected, but any questions?